Now, please welcome Vice President of Education, Workforce Development, and Evaluation at UnidosUS, Dr. Peggy McLeod.
Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the Latinas brunch. I want to welcome you to this second plenary of our first 50th anniversary. We've come together to celebrate our 50th and to contemplate all the wonderful possibilities for the next 50. I first want to thank our affiliates for joining us this year. We have a lot of affiliates here, probably more than we've ever had. Affiliates, where are you? All right. Thanks to our sponsors, BP and the Walton Family Foundation, without whom, of course, we could not have this wonderful plenary. And then finally, a huge thanks to our Unidos staff for all the hard work they put in all the time. It's particularly significant that we celebrate our 50th in DC. That while not our birthplace, is definitely our home. And I mention that because when we started planning for this conference many years ago, we did not anticipate being in the situation that we are now and today, a large and growing community made scapegoat and wedge issue. But as we heard so eloquently yesterday, we must remain hopeful. As our boss, Janet Murguia, says, in unity there is strength, and in strength there is power, and boy, there's a lot of power here today. In this plenary, you will hear the challenges we are experiencing as our numbers continue to grow, but you will also hear a message of hope and power, and just as importantly, how we face these challenges. Thanks again for joining us today, and please join me in thanking our wonderful panel for being here today. You're going to hear some amazing stuff from them, so thank you to them in advance, and thank you all for being here. Our time is now.
Thank you, Peggy. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Senior Director of National Strategic Relationships and Initiatives in the Office of Diversity and Inclusion at BP America, Inc., Kathleen Martinez.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm really excited to be here with you today representing BP and supporting this great institution. I'd like to thank Janet Murguia and her amazing team for their unwavering commitment to the Latino community and to helping provide a voice to those who desperately need it. Today's discussion is a critical one, and I'm excited to hear from our panelists. I would also like to take a personal moment to recognize another Latina leader that's in the room, a dear friend of mine, Raquel Tamez. Raquel, will you please stand? I know you're over here somewhere. There she is. Raquel is the CEO for the Society of Hispanic Professional Engineers, and her team is working just like UnidosUS to prepare the next generation of innovators and leaders in roles critical to the U.S. economy, crucial in industries like mine, the energy industry. So I just wanted to point out another Latina we met. We became fast friends, and we're focusing on these issues together. So thank you for being here with me today. So many of you may think of BP as just an oil and gas company, and we are an oil and gas company, but we are also so much more. BP has operations in 70 countries and employs over 74,000 people just like me worldwide. Last year alone, BP's operations contributed $85 billion to the American economy. And between 2013 and 2017, we invested more than $125 million in community programs, and more than $42 million of that focused on U.S. STEM education initiatives. We are not just oil and gas. In fact, BP has the largest operated renewable energy business among the world's major oil and gas companies. That's right. Today, BP's wind farms can produce enough electricity to produce power to all the homes in a city the size of Philadelphia, and that's U.S. wind. The energy industry is changing faster than ever, my friends. As global demand for energy continues to rise, the fuels mix is shifting towards lower carbon fuel mixes as well. Meeting the world's need for energy requires a spirit of innovation and purpose. And BP heavily relies on top talent, great scientists and engineers to help us drive this energy transition. Like many other corporations and industries in the room, BP will continue to rely on this talent, these great minds, if we intend to lead and continue to innovate for the future. Today's conversation focuses on how Latino success is critical to drive the nation forward. I agree. Education is the epicenter. If Latinos are truly to lead in critical roles throughout corporate America and across our country. On your seats, you should have a copy of an executive summary to report titled The State of STEM. I encourage you to read it. And you can download the full version of the report if you'd like at stemconnector.com. Together, women and minorities make up more than half of today's population. Yet they are much less likely to earn degrees in science, technology, engineering, and math, or STEM, and even become STEM professionals. Folks, these are careers that provide great incomes. They can change the trajectory of a student's life and a family. As a community, it is imperative that we all remain committed to improving pathways to education and careers in demand, especially for girls and underrepresented minorities, our Latinos, brothers and sisters. Closing these gaps in talent can pay huge dividends for industry and for our community. And that, my friends, is where we all need to do better within our communities. We need to demand better. We must get involved in the local, state, and national levels to ensure that a quality education is not limited to certain zip codes. But lastly, I want you to know something specific that I think is very important. A good education alone is no longer enough to be at the top of our game in today's global economy. We need to ensure that young Latino students are not only learning technical skills that they need, but developing power skills. Skills that they need to be adaptable in a constantly changing global market. Skills like emotional intelligence, problem solving, critical thinking, communication and cognitive flexibility, the ability to synthesize information, test theories, and hypotheses. I joined BP in 2012. I work for a company that is committed to its employees, makes employees a priority, is committed to the community, and is committed to increasing diversity among our ranks. This is a commitment that starts at the very top. In my role at BP, I get to help make that difference. And for that, I am honestly proud to say I work for BP, and even more proud to be here with you today. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathleen and BP, for your continued commitment. Damas y caballeros, please welcome General Counsel for the Walton Family Foundation, Lisa Montes.
Hi, I'm proud here today to represent the Walton Family Foundation. As many of you know, we are a family-led foundation that for 30 years has focused on providing access and opportunities to people and communities. We are carrying out the vision of our founders, Sam and Helen Walton, who believed in a world where people could accomplish anything when they have opportunity and encouragement. This vision guides our efforts to improve K-12 education for all students, to protect our oceans and rivers while also protecting the livelihoods of fishermen, farmers, and ranchers, and to advance the quality of life in Northwest Arkansas and the Delta region of Arkansas and Mississippi, the communities that first gave the Walton family opportunity. We are proud to be a funder of UnidosUS for the past 15 years and their commitment to building a stronger America by creating opportunities for the Latino community. our joint efforts to advance educational equity and close the achievement gap are making a difference in the lives of students. At our core, we believe that children should have access to great options for high-quality schools, no matter their means or their zip code in which they live. Thank you for being here, and thank you for being part of this conversation.
Thank you, Lisa, and the Walton Family Foundation for continuing to believe in this important work. Now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Director of the Hill Latino and Plenary Moderator, Viana Marrero.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to this afternoon's plenary session. Our time is now. How Latinos' success in education, innovation, and at the polls will drive the nation forward. I'm excited to be leading this conversation with you all today, especially given the work that I've been doing for the past couple years as the founder and director of The Hill Latino. We're reaching millions of Latinos on thehill.com, but more importantly, our coverage of Latino issues is also reaching non-Latino policymakers and thought leaders who turn to us to better understand the changing demographics of the country and what it means for policymaking. It's no secret that Latinos are projected to make up 26% of the overall U.S. population by 2050. But what does this mean for our communities and our country? What roles are Latinos expected to play in American society? America's future and competitiveness are increasingly contingent on the success of the Latino community. What are advocates, corporate executives, and policy leaders doing to ensure educational attainment and equity, economic stability and mobility, as well as civic and political participation and representation? What types of policies, practices, and strategies can be used to improve educational attainment, job prospects, and civic engagement among the Latino community? How can we encourage more Latinos to go into fields where they're typically underrepresented? What's being done to spur more Latinos to pursue a career in politics and hold politicians accountable at the ballot box? We'll be discussing all these questions and more with our incredible roster of speakers. Just a couple quick reminders before we begin. In addition to the audience here, UnidosUS is also live streaming on Facebook Live. Please do keep your phones on silent, but we encourage you to engage in the conversation on social media. You can use the hashtag UnidosUS18. Also, please start thinking of your questions, as you will have the opportunity to submit questions to UnidosUS staff during the program. So now I'd like to bring our panelists to the stage. First, Maria Flynn is president and CEO of Jobs for the Future. She works with national leaders on workforce development issues to build access to economic advancement and opportunity for U.S. employees. Maria has 25 years of experience in the workforce development and education sectors. Prior to joining Jobs for the Future in 2007, she was a member of the federal government. She was part of the senior executive service and served as the administrator of the Office of Policy Development and Research in the U.S. Department of Labor's Employment and Training Administration. Manuel Pastor, sitting next to her, is professor of Sociology and American Studies and Ethnicity at the University of Southern California. He currently directs the program for environmental and regional equity at USC and the USC Center for the Study of Immigrant Integration. Manuel's research has focused on the issues of economic, environmental, and social conditions facing low-income urban communities and the social movement seeking to change those realities. He explores these topics in great depth in his new book, State of Resistance: What California's Dizzying Descent and Remarkable Resurgence Means for America's Future. And we have Ileana Gonzalez next to him. She's the assistant professor at Johns Hopkins University School of Education. She also manages the University School Counseling Fellows Program. Prior to her doctoral work, she served as an urban high school counselor in South Florida, serving primarily Caribbean immigrant populations. And finally, Clarissa Martinez de Castro is Deputy Vice President at UnidosUS, Office of Research, Advocacy, and Legislation. In this capacity, she leads the organization's immigration policy efforts and works to expand Latino civic engagement. A frequent media commentator on the Latino electorate and immigration, she also heads up Unidos' new Rise Above campaign, an initiative that aims to demonstrate the powerful contributions of diversity to American society. So let's get started.
So Manuel, I'm going to start with you. Let's start with the country's changing demographics. The Latino population in the U.S. is really experiencing enormous growth, as we all know. And as a researcher, you've studied this phenomenon and this impact specifically in California. What lessons have you learned, and what can you tell us about the implications for the country's future?
Well, thanks. Glad to be here. And so the one thing to kind of remember, and I know people who are not from California don't necessarily want to hear it, is that the demographic change in California between 1980 and 2000, when California went from being about two-thirds white to being majority people of color, is roughly the demographic change that the United States is going through between 2000 and 2050. So California in some ways is America fast forward, and in particular this last election was basically the nation's Prop 187 moment, kind of freak out around undocumented immigrants. But what people forget about California in that era is not only were we dealing with issues around immigration, but half of the country's net job losses in the early 1990s occurred in California, and Rush Limbaugh began his talk radio career in the 1980s, in late 1980s in California. So that sort of perfect combination or storm of demographic anxiety, economic uncertainty, and profiteering from political polarization. We did it first, and we fucked it up pretty bad. So, but at the end of that process, where we are right now, we've got a state that's proudly declared itself to be a sanctuary state in terms of protecting its undocumented residents, a state that's moved ahead on the minimum wage, a state that's moved ahead on deincarceration, et cetera. And so I think it's really important to sort of understand what that's going to look like potentially for but how did that happen in California, and then why it's crucial to understand the lessons of that for the country. Because particularly the demographic change, you know, when people hear about the United States becoming majority people of color by about 2045, at about a quarter Latino by that moment, what they're usually anticipating is that all that change is going to still occur in California, that by the year 2045, California will be 150% Latino. There'll be sort of super Chicanos marching the earth going, Aslan y que, we're back la Reconquista, right? But really what's going on is it's occurring in the rest of the country. Los Angeles is the only large metro area in the last 10 years that did not see an increase in the number of Hispanic children. We're kind of coming to the end of a demographic process, and the growth now is occurring in places like the South, the Midwest, et cetera. Right now, it's kind of hard to believe, currently the 13th most Latino state in the United States is Utah. I know, you're thinking like, Utah's not just white, it's sort of shiny white, right? Sort of Book of Mormon white, right? And that was the case with Utah back in 1970, but it's undergone a massive demographic transformation. So if this is coming to a theater near you, to the rest of the country, what are the lessons from California? I think the first thing is that change is very bumpy. You know, the shock of new folks coming in, the discomfort that has been caused, the political turmoil that we went through in the 1990s, this is something that's really key to what's going on in the rest of the country. The second thing that I would lift up about this demographic change is something people don't pay a lot of attention to. And it has to do with the age structure of the populations. If you look at the median age, half older, half younger, of the non-Hispanic white population in the United States, it's 43 years. For the Asian Pacific Islander population, it's 36. For the African American and Native American population, it's 33. For the Latino population, it's 28. So 43, 28, 15 years. It's a generation gap, which does two things. It helps to explain our demographic change, because when you're 28, you're in prime family formation age. When you're 43, you think you're in prime family formation age. May well be. But it also helps to explain our politics, because if you look at what we've called the racial generation gap, the percent of those above the age of 65 who are white compared to those below the age of 18 who are kids of color. The state in the United States with the largest racial generation gap is Arizona. With its fractious politics around immigration, ethnic studies in the schools, and until this recent teacher strike, looping back to education, it had the largest per capita K through 12 cuts in spending of any state in the United States over the last 8 years. An older generation looking at a younger generation not seeing itself and not investing. Interestingly, the peak of the racial generation gap in California occurred between 1994 and 1998, the years of Prop 187, elimination of bilingual education, elimination of affirmative action. The peak for the racial generation gap, according to demographers and projections going forward for the United States as a whole, 2016, the election of Donald Trump. So this racial generation gap is very important. The last thing I would say is that while we may say, well, you know, this is all going to change because, like in California, there'll be more Latinos, and that'll be a good thing. And by the way, it will be a good thing. But demography is not necessarily destiny. You know, Texas has a lot of Latinos, and not a lot has changed politically in that state. Moreover, it's not going to change until we recognize a couple of different things. We need to actually activate people to vote. So it's not enough that they're mad at what's going on. They need to be mad enough to naturalize, if they have not yet naturalized, to register, if they're not yet registered, and to become solid voters, even in midterm elections and not just occasional voters, in order to actually exercise power. The second thing that I would really emphasize that I think is an important part of the California story, as much as it's a Latino story, and it's that Latino part of the story has been portrayed very well in a new book by my colleague David Ayon, written with George Pla, called Power Shift, looking at the kind of rise of Latino politics in California and what that means for the United States. It's also a story of building alliances with other groups. So Latinos will only be as powerful as we are able to build alliances with African Americans, with Asian Pacific Islanders, with what folks in the white community who are interested in the same set of issues, with labor, et cetera. We cannot go it alone. We're going to need to be building those kind of alliances, and that's a different set of skills that we really need to develop.
I had a few follow-up questions, but I think I might give the ladies a few minutes to jump in first. So Maria, given that Latinos already are making up a really large part of the U.S. workforce, what can corporate America and policy leaders do to ensure that they have access to high-quality jobs?
Great. That's a great question, and good afternoon, everybody. It's great to be here. So I am the CEO of an organization called Jobs for the Future. We're a national nonprofit organization that does work all around the country, and our mission is really to help underserved young people and adults attain post-secondary credentials and move into family-sustaining jobs. And so, you know, the issues around the Latino population are, you know, deeply important to us. And it's great to be here to share some of our work. I think to start, I think it's important to think that not only are we in the midst of a really important demographic shift, but we're also in the midst of a very important shift when it comes to jobs and skills in our country. And I would kind of set the stage by saying I think we're kind of seeing an intersection of two really important things happening. First is that, you know, we hear a lot about the low unemployment rate, and there, you know, there's a lot of good things about that, the lowest unemployment rate in 18 years, I believe. But at the same time, we know that far too many folks, particularly in the Latino community, are being left behind by this economy. The Federal Reserve came out with a report about a month ago that showed that 50% of working Latino parents are earning below 200% of federal poverty level, which means that half of working Latino parents are making less than $50,000 a year. At a time when if you live in Boston or LA, like Manuel and I do, or here in DC, it costs probably, you know, over $30,000 to even rent a two-bedroom apartment per year. So the story of the great economy, I think, I worry, is kind of overshadowing a lot of the subcontext of what is really happening in our communities when it comes to jobs and wages. And then if you kind of layer on top of that, what we're seeing around advances in technology, automation, kind of the changing nature of work, you know, a shift to a lot more 1099 jobs, the gig economy and so on, and how rapidly that change is occurring. If you just think of, you know, kind of the changes that technology may have brought to your own life in the past 5 or 10 years, it's pretty dramatic, I'm sure. So how do we ensure and how do we start to take action now to make sure that the folks who are already unfortunately being left behind in the economy can catch up and not be left further behind as, you know, these kind of technological changes continue to advance. So, you know, I think the time really is now when it comes to these issues. And as Diana said, I think both corporate America and policymakers have huge roles to play. So in terms of corporate America, I think that, you know, I think we would, most of us, not all of us would agree that we are certainly not in the best political or policy environment these days. And so I really think that it's time for corporate America to be more of a leader on these issues. In the 25 plus years I've been working in education and workforce, I've seen the private sector do an awful lot of finger pointing. You know, oh, it's the school's fault. It's, you know, the school district's fault. It's the community college's fault. It's so-and-so's fault. And I think it's time, you know, that we stop the finger pointing and that corporate America really start to, you know, take a stand and start to invest in the talent that they need. You know, we are, you know, we hear a lot about skill shortages, about companies not finding the skilled workers that they require. And I think that there are a lot of great ways that companies can start taking action. And I really like the remarks by BP, because I think that's some great examples of what we're starting to see a lot of other companies starting to do. I think, you know, thinking about things like paid work-based learning experiences, both for young people and adults, thinking about registered apprenticeship opportunities, thinking about how to, you know, what steps can you take to build awareness about the careers that exist in your company. I have an eighth grade girl at home, and she often talks to me about the fact that in middle school, no one ever talked about careers, you know, to her class. And she knows what I do for a living. And she said, Mom, isn't that weird? And I say, yeah, that's weird and unfortunate. But unfortunately, I think that's all too often the reality. So the more that corporate America can help kind of build that awareness and those opportunities, and also to really think about not only awareness, but pathways. How can you build pathways of advancement within your company? We're seeing companies like Walmart even think about what are pathways outside of their company, you know, what are adjacent sectors that employees can move up and into if, you know, kind of opportunities don't exist within the company that they're currently working. So I think the more we see companies kind of expand their point of view, the better off we're going to be. And in terms of policymakers, you know, I know in Congress, there's talk about reauthorization of the Perkins Career and Technical Education Act and the Higher Education Act. I think it's important that, particularly around post-secondary success, that policymakers really think about what elements need to be in place to help ensure that Latinos get access to high-quality post-secondary opportunities and have the supports that they need to complete those opportunities. And so keeping in mind, you know, that very often Latino students might be first-generation college-going. They may have unmet financial needs. They may have language barriers. And the statistics show that often there are, you know, a lot of kind of college readiness issues that need to be addressed. So how can we look at reauthorization of the Higher Ed Act with those things in mind?
Just one quick thing. When you talk about technical training, to what degree do you worry that Latinos and people of color are going to be pushed toward technical training versus more liberal arts, you know, education?
Yeah. So I think that we need to be extremely cautious to not be tracking anyone in certain directions. So I think that that's why I think awareness of what the opportunities are across the board is really critical. And I think building awareness of, you know, what good jobs exist kind of at different levels. You know, what will an apprenticeship get you? What will a two-year degree? What will a four-year degree? And, you know, what careers and what occupations are actually opportunities for advancement versus more dead ends?
Great, thank you. So Clarissa, can you tell us a little bit more about the work that you do to encourage more Latino participation at the ballot box? We started talking a little bit about that with Manuel, but would love your perspective on, you know, what can be done to, or what is being done to encourage young Latinos to vote consistently, you know, as soon as they turn 18, and to do it not just in presidential elections, but all elections.
Yeah, and I think that the fact that we're having a panel where we're talking really intently about education and what does voting have to do with it is because the reality is that all of these issues are intertwined. In order to have strong communities, education is important both for the present and for the future, for the way that our kids are going to be prepared to go into jobs that are going to allow them to provide for their families with dignity and with a living wage. The health care that they need to access through those jobs or other means to be able to do those things. And frankly, voting has to do with all of that, because how we approach education and the choices we make also have to do with what value we place on the children that are going to be educated, that are being educated, and that will be part of that workforce. Politicians care about a lot of things, but two things that all of them care about is votes and money, because they need that in order to be successful. And our community has a lot of votes, and a lot more votes that right now we're still leaving on the table. So the Latino electorate is growing at a fast clip. More Latinos are voting. In 2016, we had about 12 million Latinos who voted, and that was an increase of over 13% from the previous presidential. But we also had 12 million Latino citizens who were eligible and were not yet registered. And what we are seeing, no surprise perhaps, is that at the same time that the pool of potential voters in our community is going like this, investment in voter registration and engaging those very voters is going like this. If you think about the obscene amount of money that gets spent in any election, a sprinkle at best is spent on voter registration, which is one of the biggest opportunities for our community to close that gap, in addition to working on helping those who are eligible become citizens. In some ways, people who invest the resources in election cycles only care about whether their candidate or party is going to win. And I believe that for all of us, our candidate is that Latino or that Latina voter. And so part of what we are doing is partnering with many of you in the room and beyond to figure out not only how do we work with our Unidos family to make citizenship available to those who are eligible, but also to bring voter registration to where people are. So we're doing community canvassing in places like Florida, in Pennsylvania. We're working with affiliates in 11 states to increase their capacity. They don't do voter registration day in and day out. They have day jobs like most people, right? Very few operations are voter operations 24/7. But to increase the capacity so they can offer that opportunity and that information to the communities they serve, which also is going to increase the power base and the influence of those very organizations. And also to realizing that we are a young community. Not only do we have 12 million who are eligible right now, but we are adding about 1 million more Latino citizens who are turning 18 every year. And so we have partnered with the beauty of having a family as diverse as the Unidos family is that you have curriculum developer experts in our education teams, you have our civic engagement organizers, and you have schools in our network. So we partner with high school administrators and teachers and students to create a high school democracy curriculum, so that we don't just ask students and schools and teachers to do more, but we can partner with them and create the tools that they need to do that. Curriculum that includes not just getting registered to vote, but frankly, how our government works and how we as citizens in the civic sense have our role to play to make sure that it works. And so our hope with that is that we can partner across the country to make voter registration a rite of passage of graduation. And at the same time, we need the help of every single one of us. So imagine if the 12 million Latinos who voted registered one Latino who is not registered, we would close that gap. So we are also creating online tools to make sure that you have that ability in the palm of your hand. So if you go to becomeavoter.org, you can carry that in your phone, and whenever you come across your niece, your nephew, your abuelita, your comadre, or your compadre who hasn't registered yet, you have the ability to bring that to them and to make sure then that we together help remind people when that day is coming and we go together and we make it not an isolated act, which voting sometimes feels, but a family and a community act. So we're creating those tools so that we can empower ourselves to increase our electorate and our voice. And we are not alone. We have a lot of Latino sister organizations and sister organizations in other communities who are working to do the same and together create the energy so that our communities can stand up. Because right now, more than ever, voting is an act of self-defense and of community solidarity.
So can you build on something? Just briefly, when we talk about Texas, can you talk about why don't Latinos vote or vote in the numbers that they can vote in Texas in particular?
There's a lot of factors at play. I'll start by acknowledging our own responsibility as a community and needing to do that. And I think that we are stepping up in many ways to do that. But a lot of times during election season, the coverage tends to be going into elections. Latinos don't vote. People shouldn't bother trying to mobilize that vote because they don't vote. And there is no investment and there is no mobilization. But then at the other end of the election, when people who wanted Latinos to vote for their candidates, when those candidates lose, they turn around and blame the Latino community. They also blame the African American community for not coming out to vote, even though they didn't even bother to meaningfully engage those communities, right? And so in Texas, you see an interesting thing that you also see in California. So more than 50% of Latinos are concentrated in Texas, California, and Florida. Mm-hmm. What is the difference between those three states, generally speaking? Florida is a battleground state. You look at a place like Nevada. Nevada is a battleground state. Latino voting performance has been growing there faster than in other places. There is more energy, there's more action, there's more contact. Even in those places, highly likely Latino voters still get less contact than other voters, but they get a lot more than in other places. And what you often hear too, I remember, you know, no matter where I was going to Iowa or Colorado or other communities, you go talk to folks and they say, nobody's ever come to talk to me about voting. And the other thing people say is, I don't feel that I know enough to vote, right? Now, we are a nonpartisan organization, as most of you, and we cannot tell people who to vote for. But we can help them get information and make sure that they are informed about the issues that impact their communities and have a compass to look at what at candidates and parties say. And then, frankly, what I often tell people, too, is there's a hell of a lot of people out there that don't have a clue what they're voting for either, and they vote against their self-interest every day. Now, I don't want you to do that, but you shouldn't feel that other folks out there are really learned about this stuff. And frankly, the more that you participate, the more information that you will get. And go to community organizations that you trust to get that information. So in Texas, I think has been like the perfect example of lack of investment, lack of mobilization, all around. in terms of engaging the community in the franchise. And I think there's a lot of energy right now to build that and to do what it takes, just like so many organizations here did it and are doing it and leading the way in Arizona, where the voting participation of the community is happening because and by the community, not because of other folks. And the same thing we're gonna be seeing in Texas.
Ileana, do you wanna add something?
I just wanna, just a couple things real quick on Texas. One, to highlight something Gleisa said and to kind of put it together. You know, each year in the United States, 300,000 Latinos naturalize and 1 million turn 18. And so I think part of the story in Texas is really reaching out to Latino millennials and figuring out how to engage that next generation and not simply be thinking about an older generation that's naturalizing and voting. The second thing is it's hard to register people in Texas. There's a bunch of rules about needing to have your qualifications to be a registrar by county.
Yep.
The rules are set up to disenfranchise. And we cannot be taking this kind of notion that we're not doing enough when the odds are being stacked in order for people not to be able to realize their political power. We need to be getting at those rules. And then the third thing I would say about Texas, which is really key, is the need for a geographic strategy. The cities in Texas are actually pretty friendly on a lot of issues that Latinos care about. The real nut to crack is the suburbs there, but really getting at a sort of nuanced geographic strategy. That's actually part of the California story too, which is to try to build the base, particularly in Los Angeles, which had never been as liberal as the Bay Area, and then to try to get enough action going in the Inland Empire and in the Central Valley so you can at least turn it purple or into a place of contestation. And I think we sometimes think, oh my God, Texas, instead of breaking it down into San Antonio and Dallas and Houston, where you can really begin to build strength and move out into the suburbs.
That's right. So let's turn to early childhood education. Ileana, students, Latino students are the fastest growing segment of the population, but they have the lowest enrollment in early childhood education. What do you think can be done to better prepare these students for kindergarten, given the shortage of early childhood programs?
Sure. Thank you, everyone. Good afternoon. What an honor it is to be here. A child of Cuban refugees, to be on this end, it's an honor to be here with my brothers and sisters. Education is tough. It's a very long-term investment and a very long-term gain. So if we can just make a left, a real big left into the world of early childhood education, I think that when you look at early childhood education and the research around early childhood education, we see that early childhood education is linked to less absenteeism, higher academic achievement, and I think the most important thing is more parental engagement. Parental engagement is so important in schools, and I think that the more, the earlier students get involved in the world of education, it leads parents to understanding the process. With that said, I think that one of the challenges with early childhood education is parents understanding their rights and their privileges and the power that they have regardless of immigration status. And I think that we're living in a world of a lot of fear. And so for parents to understand in their community, in their states, what their rights are as far as access to early childhood education, I think that that's very important when it is available. And what I would say to parents, you know, as they prepare for early childhood education, or excuse me, if they don't have access to that early childhood education, and I think one thing that Latinos have in general is the power of language. And so one thing I would say to parents is to speak to your child, and one of the biggest power that we have as Latinos is the fact that we're bilingual. We know the statistics of what our country is gonna look like and is looking like, and so to have that power to be bilingual is key. And also the exposure, so reading to your child, exposure to libraries, exposure to museums, public transportation. Socialization skills are so important, especially you know with other children that are the same age. Definitely, I would say the biggest takeaway is for parents to unite with one another to understand their rights. I think that that's so important.
So we're going into rapid fire mode now, because we have a lot of questions to get through, and we're going to do it in couple minutes. So Clarissa and Ileana, most schools no longer teach civics education, and you already started to talk about that, Clarissa. Only 25% of U.S. students rate as proficient on the civics assessment portion of the NAEP test. It's the largest national assessment of what American students know. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about that phenomenon and what's being done or what can be done?
Sure. So NAEP is the National Assessment of Educational Progress, and when we look at NAEP and the frameworks of curriculum for NAEP in civics education, and I know that Clarissa touched upon this a little bit, is these frameworks come from a very Eurocentric white lens. And so when we don't have identification of who we are and who the student is, as part of that framework of curriculum, we tend to see the student not engage. So one thing I would urge educators and school districts is to make curriculum such that students, number one, have their own identity and are exposed to stories about their own identity, their own history. And the bigger challenge for that, because the people that have the power in that space are the educators. So firstly, I would say is for educators to also understand how their own identity, their own power, and their own privilege play into that, and to make choices about what curriculum they teach and how to empower these students in these communities. And teaching from a lens of activism, of social justice, of understanding what oppression is and how many of our students of color are marginalized and exploited. And one of the things that, if you read Pedagogy of the Oppressed by Paulo Freire, you know, he talks about how, you know, those that are oppressed are always seen as the negative, the wrong. And so, you know, one thing that Clarissa mentioned about voting and how it's always, you know, their fault for not voting, I mean, that's classic oppression. So when we think about what are ways that we as educators can change that lens to understanding that, you know, you do matter, your story does matter, your identity matters in this process, it leads to activism. And it leads to an understanding where educators can have these courageous conversations with their students about their identity and about what activism looks like. And I think we're in an age right now of cultural imperialism and the sense of, we're living in very interesting times. And I think the pendulum is swinging in a direction of youth activism. And so I think now is the time to have these conversations.
Yeah, I totally agree. And going back to Texas, right, we're seeing that unfold. Texas has an outsized influence on what goes in textbooks, for example. And I think that if you look at the body who makes those decisions, they shouldn't even be writing a cooking recipe, let alone dictating what's in textbooks. And so in some ways, what we're seeing is that they are dictating curriculum to basically educate students stupid, right? So you can go through the whole process and still graduate, and your education is not really preparing you for the future. The reality is that there are teachers out there who really care and are looking for curriculum that works with their students. And that was one of the reasons we partnered to do this high school democracy curriculum, to do something that was culturally competent. And I don't mean culturally competent just in the sense of Latinos or language. Right? Cultural competence in the way that it speaks to youth. So youth were involved in developing, and young students from Texas, from California, and who they now are talking to students in other places. But it's also important to, I think about what you said, and the reality is that I think right now youth are getting a crash course in civic education. And one of the things that we want to make sure is that part of that crash course is also mindful that there are forces at play who are more than happy to see this distrust of institutions and the anger towards government to dismantle government, right? And I think that we really have to engage together in not being parties to the destruction of government, which has a role to play in making sure that all Americans have an equal chance. But in actually, because what they're trying to do, right, is to destroy it or dismantle it, but replace it with nothing. And what we need to do is to hold it accountable and to fix it, to reimagine it. And so we can't let our youth get buy into that disillusionment that just throws the baby out with the bathwater, but instead to put the for buy-in of the people back into the government equation and to bring accountability back into the process. We've heard these themes through the conference about the nature of toxic narratives and why they are used. And one of the big reasons they are used is to keep people who have similar challenges and aspirations from coming together to actually hold accountable the people who have the ability to inflict those challenges upon them. And so we can't let this solution go to the extent where we are destroying, but rather we have to reimagine. And I think that the activism on the streets, together with caring teachers who need our support to fight the structures that are saying, you cannot teach that, you have to teach out of this useless book, and give them and partner with them with the tools so that civic education can be tangible and can be real.
So, I could just echo and kind of, I think one of the challenges that we see institutionally is the fact that teachers are accountable by these NAEP scores and data to show that these students are learning what comes out of these textbooks. So part of that challenge, the next level is, how do we elect folks that make these decisions in local school boards to not make teachers accountable to this curriculum, but to their own imaginative curriculum or curriculum that represents who these students and these communities are?
So let's stay with education. Maria, there are a lot of jobs that don't require a college degree, but they do require post-secondary education. How do we train and match job seekers to those types of opportunities? And can you point to any specific examples where that's working well?
Sure, yeah, a couple of examples. So this is it's a critical issue. So more and more, I think almost 90% of the jobs being created today require some type of education or training beyond high school. And yet we know as a whole in the US, there are about 90 million adults in the US who do not have any education or training beyond high school. So there's a big, big gap there and probably a growing gap. So we're looking at a number of issues. So one is the issue of kind of degree inflation, and Joe Fuller from the Harvard Business School has a great recent paper out that really looked at how companies are requiring degrees for jobs that really don't need a degree. And even within JFF, we've been starting to really take a hard look at our own degree requirements on our jobs. And so I encourage everyone to really do that. At the same time, again, as the BP sponsor suggested, we have kind of this dual importance of technical skills and, as she put it, power skills, and I think that's another issue that's going to be increasingly important, right? How are we able to both kind of train in the skills and assess, folks' ability to work in teams, to self-advocate, kind of the skills that are going to be more and more important as we move into kind of the future of work. And then, there's also strands of folks who are looking at the issue of kind of skills-based hiring. So not just kind of removing degree requirements, but really thinking about hiring based on what people can demonstrate that they know. And so Opportunity at Work, which is another national nonprofit based here in DC, is doing a lot of work in that area. And there's also some really interesting kind of startup companies like Skillist, for example, who are starting to look at that both on the supply and the demand side of the labor market, really matching folks who may not have a four-year degree with the employers who are looking for that talent. And then, the last thing I would mention is just, I think, again, as skill needs increasingly change, we need to increasingly be looking at ways to accelerate learning. And I think that's particularly important for Latino students, especially folks who are trying to balance family and school and work. And so looking at models where you can do concurrent kind of basic skills and occupational training, I think, is a great model. Even in high school, looking at dual enrollment models where in Texas districts like Brownsville, Far San Juan, Alamo, for example, we have really great results with low-income Latino students who are actually graduating high school with also a two-year associate's degree. So I think, accelerating your learning, really taking a hard look at those degree requirements and really looking kind of at new ways to match supply and demand.
So So just a quick reminder, if you haven't submitted questions, we're going to be taking questions in about 10 minutes. So Manuel, you've studied the ways that economic development strategies have impacted or affected low-income urban communities. Can you talk more about what you've found and what community-based organizations are doing to encounter the impact of gentrification on these communities?
So a quick round question about gentrification. So which is of course one of the biggest challenges facing our urban areas. So let me just say a couple things about that. So the forces driving it are really large. One of them is the sort of changing economy, which has put a premium on knowledge work, and a lot of that's occurring in cities, put a premium on clustering together, a lot of that's in cities, and also the underlying level of income inequality. The United States right now is as unequal as it was during the Gilded Age or during the period right before the Great Depression. So that underlying economic inequality has also allowed people who have lots of wealth to basically drive rental markets with prices up and others scrambling and overcrowding to be able to fit in. The second big driver of gentrification is demographics, and in a very particular way, one of it has to do with sort of these millennials. And the millennials are a group that have two characteristics that I think are really crucial to understanding the process of what's going on. One is, when I was growing up, many of you were, I'm 62, some of you are younger, but you'll remember that you were always told that one good way to protect your assets was to buy a house. Boy, that didn't work out for a lot of people who bought their house more recently, particularly Latinos, and then had their wealth wiped away during the Great Recession and the financial crash. So a lot of millennials are postponing starting families. They're deciding that buying a house in a suburb very far away from where they want to live is not worth it, so they're staying in the cities, and that's creating more demand for that housing. And also millennials are more comfortable with the diversity of the cities and actually put a value on that. The third thing, and people forget about it, is the following thing. For years, we've been trying to do public policy to try to have our cities come back, and we're not used to it when public policies actually work. That is, we did all of this to make our cities and central cities cooler and hipper and wanting people to locate, and you know what? It's working, and we're just like not used to that at all. So what we really need to do, though, as we move forward, is to think about the problems of displacement that it's causing. Because you have a lot of long-term residents who are winding up being forced out of places that were very important to them, both that they simply can't afford the rents any longer. One thing I think we don't pay enough attention to is the way that business districts are changing. So a taqueria being replaced with a $4 donut shop is a real cultural loss, particularly if you do not like donuts and you do like tacos, right? So. So we need to be paying attention to those business districts as well. Unfortunately, the tools that we have are very limited to do something about this. Rent stabilization is something we need to be considering in the context of this crisis. Certainly building more affordable housing, what are called land trusts, where you actually buy up land, build housing on it, but the land itself is not allowed to rise in value at the markets. But one thing people often forget about, and I think is really crucial for the work of Unidos, U.S. is the following thing. You know, when you think about people being forced out of an area, it's because the rents went up, right? And so people say, well, we need to bring the rents down. Here's another strategy. Raise people's income. So that they can actually stay there. And here I think it's really crucial to begin firing on all cylinders. Part of it is the work that you're talking about with young folks. Part of it is about raising the minimum wage nationwide so that working people can actually afford rents. Part of it is about designing workforce development programs that actually work for immigrants. We have workforce development programs that too frequently require that you don't have a job, when in fact most immigrants, their problem is too many jobs, right, at low wages. So how can they tap into these programs at night with childcare? How can we flood the zone with English classes? Because we know that when you learn English, you can move from the back room to the front room. Statistics show that controlling for every other factor that predicts your earnings, if you learn English, your income's gonna go up by 15%. So we've got a lot of tools that we can do to do something about this, but we really need to really change the public will to do this.
On the wage issue. So we on Labor Day, we're going to be opening a competition called the $1 Billion Wage Gain Challenge with some initial funding from Schmidt Futures, which is Eric Schmidt's foundation. And the idea is to really seek out both existing and emerging solutions that are designed to increase wages. So, and the $1 billion comes from the idea of raising 100,000 workers' income by $10,000 a year, so kind of a unicorn for the middle class, so to speak. So just something to keep an eye out for.
That's great. Elena, from your perspective, can you tell us a little more about specific communities where you feel they're generating greater access to quality education for all students, including Latinos and communities of color? And if you can give us some common strands that you're seeing in those communities.
Sure. So I think the first thing is to probably start out by defining what is a quality education, right? And understanding that there's a belief system that, you know, my parents used to tell me, education's the great equalizer. Well, that's the under assumption there is that everyone's coming to the table at the exact same place, and that's not the case a lot of times. So I think, you know, quality education for me means one that is equitable and one that understands the needs of the population it serves. And so when we think about community strands that I see of communities that work, you know, as far as access to education, I think for one, it's, you know, the people that are trying to change and are trying to do this work are coming from a lens of not a savior lens, right? They're not coming from a place of I am more than you, I have more power than you, and so I'm going to come in and quote save you. I think they come from an assumption where they change the perspective and lens to understand that the power lies within that community. And so the way that they engage with the people in the community is a completely different perspective. I can't tell you how many times I've sat in with, you know, academics that are making a lot of decisions for a community, and I, you know, raise my little hand and say, have we asked anybody in that community what they need? No, yeah, that's a good idea. And so I think that collecting data from the people that matter, the people that these policies and procedures affect, is key. I also think empowering that community and making them the leaders, the ones that are the activists for change, is so important. And so, you know, a lot of times I talk to my students that as educators, we are not ones that pull the hand, but actually push forward. And so part of that process is learning about, you know, what we've talked about already, how do we do activism, how do we have our voice, how do we understand the power that we have as citizens in order to enact change. And so I think for me, you know, when we think about communities that work, are communities that are partnering with institutions that have power, but these institutions or these organizations come from that lens of, you know, I have the connection, but really it's you that has that power.
Great, we have just a couple more minutes. So Clarissa, can you talk a little bit about the what's happening on the border with migrant children being separated from their parents? And you know, it really has mobilized the Latino community to get more involved. Can you tell us more about, you know, what can Latinos do if they want to get involved? What do you tell them? And what steps do you encourage them to take?
So I think that, that's another gigantic issue, but I take solace in the fact that I know we have talked about it in a lot of different places throughout our conference. So the way that I would summarize it is, because of everything we've been talking about, we need to make sure that every action we take responds to the moment, and it's also building towards the long-term transformational policy change that we need. And we have, no matter where you are, no matter where you sit, there's something that you can do. First and foremost, I would say lend a hand. There are organizations who are providing legal assistance to children and parents that need to be reunited. including those who are being released and left to their own devices without any guidance. So donate and lend a hand to those folks, and if you're a lawyer, volunteer. Be relentless. Don't let attention recede. And this is particularly important because what we're seeing at the border is the tip of the iceberg. It's actually zooming in into a situation that's been unfolding in communities across the country, not just now, but years and years now. And it is also important to zoom out because what's happening to those kids right now, we know that this administration has plans to try to do that to millions of children in the U.S., the majority of whom are United States citizens. Kids who their parents are getting picked up in unnecessary and destructive worksite raids. Kids whose parents are showing up to appointments with ICE or other entities not to be let out again. Kids whose parents are some of the most vetted immigrants in our country, whether because they're temporary protected status recipients who've been here for 10, 20 years, or DACA recipients, and whose status is under threat. So it is important to be relentless and to take this opportunity that has captured the public consciousness about the viciousness and the devaluing of these populations, our populations, to help them connect the dots that this is not just happening on the border and that it has nothing to do with security. So I would make sure that we are relentless in that process, and I would be remiss if I didn't bring it back then to also the voting piece. So the relentless part also includes not only bearing witness, but calling your members of Congress. Like, you should have them on speed dial, and they should get to know your name. Congress has a constitutional duty to provide oversight over these agencies and what they do, and they are not doing that. So we should be asking them all the time, even if it's just to be a pebble on their shoe, what are they doing about it? And it is important to do that because, frankly, they are trying to build the case for more money for this deportation machine, for more boots and more camps. And that fight is coming in a couple of months, and it's going to unfold in Congress. And we need to block that because without the resources to do it, they're not going to be able to inflict the damage they're planning on. And the other thing that's coming up in a couple of months is an election. And Latinos have a significant, if not pivotal, role to play in at least 25 competitive districts at a time when there's a battle brewing for control of the House. But this is not just about blue and red. Going to the purple that Manuel was talking about, this is about when you have competitive districts, members cannot go batshit crazy. They need to be moderates. They need to look at the interest of their constituents. And for anyone who cares about strong communities, the growth of the Latino electorate should be a welcome development. Because our community wants to see affordable housing, access to health care, quality educations, and good jobs. So I take it back to voting. But the education piece is both educating the rest of our fellow Americans that this issue is just the tip of the iceberg, that we need to zoom out and look at the forest for the trees, and that we need to educate and hold accountable our members of Congress to do that.
Manuel, I know you wanted to ask something.
When the children and this recent incident began to get separated from parents, and that became widespread knowledge, I was surprised that people were surprised. And I think what we, because as you've been saying, it's been happening for quite some time. What I think people don't fully realize is the undocumented population has fundamentally transformed over the last decade. If we were talking 20 years ago, we'd be talking about a group of people who were recently arrived, not very well established in the community, on average. But now, the about somewhere between 60% and two-thirds of undocumented immigrants have been in the country for longer than a decade. If you take the 11 million undocumented, they're matched by 9 million U.S. citizen family members who live in the same household, not to mention family members who live someplace else, and another 2.5 million lawful permanent resident family members living in the same household. So now every deportation is much more likely to disrupt a family, to shred a business, to create a tear in the community fabric. And so, you know, it's been going on for a while. The shock of the new, I mean, what was not clear about the cruelty and the othering that has been part of our politics for the last couple of years? You know, I just have an op-ed that's come out in Newsweek. You know, when you've been playing dog whistle racial politics for years, don't be surprised when somebody with a racist bullhorn walks in and finds a completely warmed up audience. And that is what we're living through right now.
So I think we have time for a couple questions from the audience, and I know some of you have been submitting them. Felisa, can you share some of the questions you've been receiving?
Sure. Thank you. We have questions from all over the spectrum, but this one has to do with elections and who's in power. So can you provide examples of how we could disrupt the narrative of who holds power, typically non-people of color, and examples of how meaningful coalitions have been built between Black and brown people to drive their own shared destinies?
So I have to talk about that. Clarissa bet me that I couldn't get through this whole thing without talking a lot about my book and new book, which is, and I didn't want her to lose the bet. So brand new book, State of Resistance. Very good, came out on April 3rd, got a front page New York Times review, very positive, about to be made into a major motion picture. That's one of the reasons I have to rush
back. He won't be playing himself.
That is true. When we were negotiating, I was going to be portrayed by Antonio Banderas. I was very excited. Turns out it's George Lopez, but it's a movie. So. But I think that's one of the really key parts of the California. There are many key parts of the California story, including demographic change, the way the economy shifted, the way the political rules changed. But a lot of it has to do with social movement and community-based organizations deciding to get deeply engaged in the electoral game. That is, instead of saying that politics was something that somebody else did and we organized around community services, instead trying to think about what is now called in California integrated voter engagement. That is to not simply touch somebody at the time of an election, but to form a relationship with them through community organizing in order to really motivate that new and occasional voter. And then also, to do something which I think is equally profound. You know, the thing that we consider a legitimate exercise of your political rights in the United States is voting. But if that's almost like a sort of gateway drug to doing something else.
That's right.
Showing up for a march, going to a city council meeting, making that phone call, et cetera. So integrated voter engagement is community organizing meets electoral politics. And when you do that, you do have to, in these multi-ethnic situations, really begin to build lots of alliances between African American and Latino groups. That's been a key part of the California story. Another key thing, and then I'll stop there, but buy the book, it's really good. I don't have any here, but I have cards, and like, it's a page turner, you'll just start it tonight and keep on going. But another really key thing, you know, Kevin De Leon, our president pro tem, just stepped down from the state senate, who really was the architect of the sanctuary state strategy, has really pushed on so many things, along with others, to provide health care to undocumented, to make it easier for people to register and vote, et cetera, cut his teeth organizing against Proposition 187. Mm-hmm. The arc between community activism, straight into electoral politics, building that pipeline of people who are really fully engaged, I think is absolutely critical.
Yeah, and just to add a recent example, right, because I think sometimes people ask that question, and rightfully, we go back to many of the civil rights battles and fights, but I do want to use a recent iteration of that. With the Every Student Succeed Act that passed a couple of years ago, civil rights organizations came together to hold the line on a number of measures that needed to be part of that, to achieve quality education standards for African American students, but also the African American organizations like the National Urban League and the NAACP standing with Unidos to make sure that it also included provisions to have high standards for English language learners. And now that obviously that is being sent back to the states for the states to interpret how they're going to implement that law, we are working at the state level with those very organizations to make sure that the implementation is one that actually is faithful to the needs of our kids in those states. And we are working with many of our affiliates in those states, as the National Urban League is working with their affiliates on those states, to make sure that our folks know each other, create partnerships and networks to, in this particular scenario, push for the rightful implementation of ESSA, but that in those relationships, there's opportunities to also work in other areas. And I have to say that the voice of the African American community and the issue of immigration has been incredibly strong, sometimes even stronger than our own Latino leaders. And that has been very important and will continue to be an important part of that collaboration.
So we're gonna try to get one or two more in.
Felisa? Yes, and good segue to education. The next question has to do with the educators pipeline. As we continue to see the demographic shift, what strategies should we implement to see a similar shift in the teacher workforce as well as school leaders? And in particular, young millennials, how do we get them into the teaching profession?
So I can take that question or start to take that question. I think one of the challenges too is that again, going back to who's in power and making decisions about education, and going back to a wage and what we pay our educators. The United States is one of the most least cost-effective countries in the world when it comes to the input of money that they put in with educators and the output. And so I think that one of the challenges that we face is what kind of salary are many educators working in for? You know, we think about this generation of children of immigrants, first generations, 1.5s, and the salary that they need in order to have economic mobility. Sometimes being a teacher isn't that wage. And so, you know, they look to career opportunities that could potentially give them more upward mobility. So I think paying teachers, paying educators more money, yes, for that, is so important in order to diversify our workforce. And I also think the recruitment and retention. If you look at the literature, teachers of color are more, urban teachers are more likely to quit after the first 5 years or in the first 5 years of their career. And so when we think about what kind of mentoring do we do for new teachers, new educators, what kind of, you know, how do we set these educators up for success? How do we prepare them for the reality of urban schools? I think it's so important, you know, that we get into the reality. And I think also from the other perspective is, you know, which is my one of my roles at Hopkins, is how do we teach these folks to be social justice advocates? How do we make them understand how their belief system, and I always tell my students, with great power comes great responsibility. And I think being an educator is one of the most powerful positions that we have. And so how do we use that power in an equitable manner to pass along that power to the students that we teach?
Yeah, I would just add to that. I agree with everything that was said, and I would actually expand it to kind of other education and workforce kind of sector roles as well. So I think in general, we really need to think about leadership development across higher ed, you know, community college presidents, workforce development board directors, community-based organization CEOs. You know, how are we diversifying kind of the next generation of leaders kind of across these fields is really critical.
final question. And the final question is, what can organizations do to close the wage gap between Latinos and others? And how do we define good jobs in this current economy, and how do we promote them?
I'll start. So I definitely think that companies and organizations really, as I said, really need to take a hard look at how they are making hiring decisions, and look looking very closely also at what their wages and what their benefit packages are. One report I'll point you to on our website that just came out about a week ago was we looked at resume data from 4 million resumes to really look at which of these middle skill jobs of jobs that require less than a 4-year degree but more than high school, which ones really lead to advancement. And so I think that really was really eye-opening to us. It showed that occupations such as dental hygienists, like if you're a dental hygienist, most likely in 5-10 years you're still going to be a dental hygienist, but the good news is that you're making a family sustaining wage. If you're a medical assistant, however, the resume data showed that there really is very little advancement there. And then there are jobs like human resource associate that are kind of the starting point to career advancement and a real career ladder. So I think really starting to dig into kind of going beyond just the middle skill job definition and really looking at where are the advancement potentials to higher wages is really critical.
I'm an economist by training. It's said about economists, if you took them, all the economists in the world, and laid them end to end, they still couldn't reach a conclusion. Let me just say that I think that as much as it's important to look at the job structure as it is, what kind of jobs we're generating and how people can enter into it, there's a need to kind of think about some fundamental things that are really wrong with the economy. One of them is that we're at 4% unemployment, but wages are not rising. Mm-hmm. That's markets not working, and that's largely because of corporate power in the marketplace. And when you look at the fact that 30, 40 years ago, the ratio of CEO pay to the average worker pay in his or her firm was about 20 or 30 to 1, and now it's about 350 to 1. And I haven't noticed the chief executives getting 15% more productive than they were, 115 times more productive than they were, 30 or 40 years ago. We really need to understand there's kind of three things I think that are key to making the economy work going forward. One is taming the top, getting rid of this excess executive compensation, getting rid of this excess inequality. The second is growing the middle, trying to figure out where those jobs are that we really want to encourage. So many of us are trying to chase biotech or Amazon's headquarters rather than trying to figure out where advanced manufacturing, nursing, and a variety of middle-skilled jobs are. And then the third thing is to lift the bottom, that is to raise the minimum wage, to do comprehensive mm-hmm. immigration reform, to provide portable benefits so that people can transfer between jobs. If you keep those three things in mind, taming the top, growing the middle, lifting the bottom, that's an economic strategy that might actually work.
I think that might be all the time we have, but unless you want to add something.
Sorry, if I don't do this, I'm not selling a book. Yeah. But we were talking about agency and putting agency back into making government what it needs to be is one of the biggest themes of our conference and what I hope everybody goes away with. And I think what Manuel was talking about is exactly about that, particularly at a time where we're seeing corporations being treated more like people than people are, right? So, but because we were talking about bringing voter registration to where people are, to the palm of your hand, and to you can take action no matter where you are. Our fearless immigration team, my colleague Carlos back there, wanted to remind all of you that there is an action you can take right there where you are sitting to fill out this card so that we can try to hold the line on yet another plan by the administration to separate families that is going to impact legal permanent residents, U.S. citizens, and that they're trying to do their shenanigans to try to drive that separation. So this is on public charge. We need to submit as many comments as possible to the agency, and you can help us drive those numbers by filling in this card and giving it to Carlos back there. So start now. Thank you.
So thank you so much to our panelists. Let's give them a big round of applause. And